Almost 50 years since the Beatles broke up, the Fab Four's huge impact on the world continues. Now, the first feature-length Beatles documentary, authorised by the band since 1970, is about to premiere. Academy Award-winning director Ron Howard is behind the Beatles 8 days a week, the touring years, and it traces the band from the early days until the moment they conquered America.
This is the greatest phenomenon of the century thus far.
Ladies and gentlemen, here are the Beatles!
We captured Liverpool and London. We were out to capture the world.
This mania was so much pressure.
We were kids. We were all pretty scared.
It's a miracle in a way they didn't go mad.
Well, we had each other
and we brought that to the music.
Wow. How good does that look? A 21-year-old Larry Kane was the only American journalist to travel with John, Paul, George and Ringo on every stop of their US tour. And Larry joins us now from our Philly studio. Hi, welcome to the show. It's great to have you with us. We're talking about 1964. It wasn't too long after President Kennedy's assassination and tension with Cuba. You were asked to tour with four long-haired lads from Liverpool in England. What did you think when you were assigned the story?
I don't want to go. I told them there were too many big things happening around the world, and especially in Miami. And why would I, a newsman, and this is exactly what I said, and you'll see it in the film, want to travel with a band that will be here in September and gone by December? Mm. And that is why I'm so brilliant.
And I tell you what, Larry, so lucky. Yeah. I mean, the fact that you were up close and personal, you were able to share all those moments with the Beatles. And I read somewhere that you were fascinated to see the sort of reaction that the Beatles had on people. You just couldn't believe it.
Well, in all honesty, it was a universal expression, a shared experience. And when you take a look at it and think about it, all those girls, whether it be in Australia, in Adelaide, when they had 400,000 people come out, or in San Francisco or Philadelphia, or just about anywhere, Vancouver, British Columbia, were staring at them and convinced that one of them was singing to them. I got letters later saying, Mr. Kane, will you let Paul know that I will meet him at the Sears Tower in Chicago at 6 o'clock on November 17th so we can get our relationship going? And that's the way it was.
It is just amazing stuff. Really, I'm a huge Beatles tragic, Larry, and I just cannot wait for this film. You went to 47 Beatles concerts, and they were so full on, you actually couldn't even hear the band over the screams of the girls. There were crazy groupies. I think Paul McCartney wrote she came in through the bathroom window about a groupie who literally crawled in through the bathroom window to try to get to him. Can you tell us, what was it like with all those fans just surrounding them at all times? It must have just been a crazy atmosphere.
It was a wild atmosphere. Let me tell you something. When I grew up in high school in the 50s, young women were not supposed to express themselves that way. They would pull their hair, they would stare at them till tears came down their eyes.
Wow.
And the most incredible part of it was the lack of security and the fact that the police didn't know what to do. I mean, here were police officers throughout the country, and some of these kids were actually cascading through the rows and stepping over seats to get 7,000 people storm the stage in Vancouver, British Columbia. They had to almost stop the concert. It was just a total mania. But a lot of people don't understand why this Ron Howard film is so brilliant, because he's taken the era and taken you there. And I watched the first cut back in April, and I had chills. I told my wife I had chills watching the movie because I felt like I was back there, and I was there. So people for the first time in their 20s or 30s or 40s are going to get a look at what it was really like at the beginning of Beatlemania, before the people started appreciating their music, their charisma, their panache, their honesty, and the fact that they were four very special young people.
I was lucky enough to be at one of the concerts in Melbourne years and years ago. Paul was my favourite. Did you have a favourite Beatle?
Yes, I did. Did you behave yourself at the concert?
Yes, I did. I went with my father. My father, and you couldn't hear a word. He stood. Everyone was standing up. It was brilliant.
Larry's avoiding the question. Who's your favourite Beatle?
My favourite Beatle was John Lennon. Oh. And that's because he appreciated the fact, like all of them did, that I asked serious questions. I'll tell you what happened one night. My mom died that summer from complications of multiple sclerosis, and they found out about it, and he and Paul came and sat down with me. I just get choked up when I remember this. Mm. And it was only a couple of weeks before the tour, and they told me about their moms. Paul's mother died when he was 14 of cancer. John's mom died in a traffic accident when he was 18. And they were consoling me. They also consoled the opening acts who were booed off the stage. Oh. They walked up every night in the airplane to make sure they were okay. Jackie DeShannon and the Righteous Brothers and the Bill Black Trio and an amazing group, the first black girl group in America, the Exciters. And they were very sensitive people. It was remarkable to me that they were intellectually curious about the world and didn't want to be asked about what they liked in a woman, what kind of hemline did they enjoy, what kind of figure, a brunette, a blonde, a redhead. They wanted serious questions. So I got along with them. Of course, they made a lot of fun of me, but I got along with them by asking serious questions. John Lennon, when he first saw me, by the way, looked at my hair, down to my shoes, and said, "You, what planet do you come from? You look like a nerd from the 1950s.
And of course, Larry, the Beatles all had very carefully crafted public images. You know, Paul was the pretty boy. John was the sort of slightly caustic cynic. Ringo was the older, funny-looking one, although, of course, all the others thought he was the cool one. And George was the kid. Did they have different sort of personalities that matched those, or were they completely different in real life? And how did they sort of interact with each other?
Completely different. John Lennon was a man who said in public what he thought in private. We know that. He could be difficult. But he was very, very honest. When he did make fun of me, he apologized later and came around through all the tour and invited me back to the back of the plane. But he was very, very frank about issues. Paul McCartney was a man who never met an audience he didn't like, ever. And he loved entertaining. And when you see some of the rare footage in this movie, you will not believe it. You'll feel like you're right on stage with them. Ringo Starr was the biggest surprise of all. He was the second most intellectually curious of the Beatles. And, you know, they took stands on that tour. And George Harrison was not as quiet as people think. In fact, we were making an emergency landing in Portland, Oregon, with a fire in the left engine of the plane, and George yelled out, "Larry, if anything should happen on this plane, it's Beatles and children out first."
Larry, the second U.S. concert in Las Vegas was important because it changed the course, I think, of history. There was a moment where you went to the Beatles and said they plan on making the audience segregated. How was that information received by the boys, and then what happened next?
Well, I'll tell you about that, and I'll tell you what Ron Howard did about that particular episode. I told them that I learned from the Miami station that I worked for that the Gator Bowl, one of the biggest football stadiums in the South in Jacksonville, was going to be segregated the night of the concert. This word came to them on about August 20th, and they had 20 days, so September 11th, 1964. They got up as a group, and I can't tell you the language they said on television, but they said, "We're not going to do it. We're not going to do it." They were led by Paul, followed by John, George, and Ringo. And the fact is that it is true, the desegregation occurred on that night and continued throughout the South at Southern stadiums. And Ron Howard and his crew found a woman who was a teenager, a black teenager in the South, and she was there. And she talks so emotionally about the fact that for the first time in her life, she was sitting next to white people. Wow. And talking to them. And today she's a renowned American historian. And just to have her from there to here and to find her from that concert was amazing. And believe me, taking a stand like that in the American South in 1964 was very, very, very gutsy.
What amazing stories. The Beatles, 8 days a week. The touring years opens in cinemas on September 16 for 1 week only. Tickets are on sale now, and bonus Shea Stadium concert footage will screen after the film. Larry Kane, what an honour to talk to you this morning. Thank you very much.